During the 1950s, the Korean War was in full swing in East Asia. The dominant fighter jets in the skies were the MiG-15 and the F-86 Sabre. American pilots found themselves lacking a significant advantage against the Soviet MiGs, especially at high altitudes, and engaging in dogfights carried tremendous risks. The most daunting aspect wasn't merely avoiding being shot down by the MiGs, it was the realization that if a pilot were to get shot down, the chances of a successful rescue were incredibly slim. Shockingly, only 10% of American airmen who were shot down during the Korean War managed to be saved. A staggering 90% of these downed aircraft had virtually no feasible chance of being rescued. Fighter pilots were compelled to utilize every ounce of their skills to stay alive, as the moment they became unable to maintain flight, they were left entirely on their own. This dire scenario sparked the curiosity of many, leading them to ponder whether an aircraft could be developed that could be airdropped to downed pilots, enabling them to fly themselves to safety. Both in Britain and the USA, these ideas were taken seriously and pursued. The challenges posed by the precarious situation of downed pilots prompted inventive thinking to explore innovative solutions to improve their chances of survival and successful escape from enemy territory. Back in 1931, a significant 19 years prior to the onset of the Korean War, an American inventor by the name of Taylor McDaniel embarked on a mission to showcase his prowess in constructing an aircraft that possessed remarkable crash resistance. McDaniel's glider, primarily constructed from rubber, boasted the unique ability to withstand impact with the ground without disintegration, ensuring the safety of the pilots and keeping the aircraft in pristine condition. In McDaniel's viewpoint, inflatable aircraft held the potential to revolutionize aviation. However, before he could fully explore this groundbreaking concept, financial constraints hindered his progress. The outbreak of World War II further hindered any experimentation in this field, as the military aviation sector wasn't inclined to entertain unconventional ideas like inflatable aircraft during such a critical time. As World War II came to a close, endeavors to develop a viable inflatable aircraft concept gained momentum. Various nations engaged in a competitive race to establish their own versions of inflatable planes. The Soviets, for instance, ventured into some audacious ideas for their infantry forces. One, they contemplated employing inflatable planes to airlift soldiers into the enemy's rear, enabling surprise attacks from behind. After completing the mission, the inflatable plane would be deflated, transported back to base, and reused. 2. Another concept involved using inflatable aircraft for transporting goods to Siberia and other remote regions where conventional cargo planes couldn't land. The strategy entailed towing several cargo-loaded inflatable planes behind a larger aircraft, which would then release them within a 50-mile radius of their destination for landing. These creative ideas highlighted the diverse and innovative applications that inflatable aircraft could potentially serve in various scenarios. Initially perceived as a cost-effective solution for airlifting supplies, the idea of inflatable planes took a hit following flight tests. The potential of using inflatable aircraft as serious military assets faded, leading to the abandonment of the concept, particularly for delivering individual soldiers behind enemy lines. In the United Kingdom, an intriguing notion emerged. The development of a reconnaissance aircraft that could be stored within a submarine or a tank. This unconventional-looking aircraft, nicknamed Flying Mattresses, garnered attention at air exhibitions but failed to progress to production. While these designs were functional, they were not exempt from challenges. The use of inflated rubber resulted in structurally unstable and slow-moving aircraft, prompting the search for a more effective material. Towards the latter part of the 1950s, engineers at Goodyear introduced an innovative composite material. This material consisted of a layer of rubber coated with neoprene, sandwiched between two fabric layers. When inflated, this material was reinforced and held together by numerous nylon tie threads. Impressively, this material possessed one of the highest strength-to-weight ratios globally, and it was named the Air Mat. Leveraging the Air Mat, Goodyear successfully crafted an inflatable aircraft that closely resembled a conventional aircraft rather than a wobbly balloon. This technological advancement significantly improved aerodynamic performance, transforming the inflatable plane into a more aerodynamically stable and functional entity. During the Korean War, the US Air Force witnessed the recurring issue of downed pilots being captured by the enemy due to the challenges of timely rescue. This predicament sparked the evolution of a remarkable idea, an inflatable plane that could be swiftly airdropped to a stranded pilot. Once received, the pilot would unpack and inflate the aircraft, start its engine, and fly to safety. This inflatable aircraft, named the Inflatoplane by Goodyear, revolutionized the understanding of air in an airplane, and its design was hailed as successful. Two models were developed, the GA-466, a two-seater, and the 468, a single-seater. At its full size, the Inflatoplane measured 19 feet 7 inches in length and had a wingspan of 22 feet. Inflation took just 5 minutes, after which the pilot would manually start the 40 horsepower engine. With a maximum load capacity of 240 pounds, the aircraft could cover a distance of 390 miles and remain airborne for 6.5 hours. It achieved a maximum speed of 72 miles per hour and cruised at 60 miles per hour. Remarkably, it required a mere 250 feet for takeoff and 350 feet for landing. The military swiftly recognized the Inflatoplane as the solution to their problem, providing a means to airdrop planes behind enemy lines, enabling stranded pilots to fly themselves to safety, a concept that had become reality. The Inflatoplane made its debut at the 1956 Chicago Auto Show, causing a sensation among aviation enthusiasts and the general public alike. Its futuristic appearance, combined with its functional inflatable structure, captured imaginations. Despite its almost science fiction-like presence, the Inflatoplane was a genuine innovation, holding the potential to forever alter the landscape of aviation. Throughout the 1950s, Goodyear embarked on the creation of several inflatable aircraft designs, each boasting enhancements in maneuverability, speed, and range. The company was confident that these aircraft could serve as life-saving tools. Compact enough to be stowed within crates and dropped from airplanes, or even packed into pods and released from aircraft wings, the concept of airdropping inflatable planes to stranded pilots had the potential to significantly reduce risks for search and rescue teams. Moreover, the process of preparing these aircraft for flight was straightforward for downed pilots. The Inflatoplane weighed a mere 200 pounds when empty. A pilot would simply need to unfold the wings and initiate the inflation process by pumping air into the aircraft. Once the plane was half inflated, activating the engine would allow it to take over and complete the inflation process. The unique stiffness provided by the air mat material allowed the Inflatoplane to maintain its shape with only 7 psi of pressure, a much lower value than that of a typical car tire. This attribute enabled rapid inflation in just 5 minutes. With a fuel capacity of 20 liters, the Inflatoplane demonstrated respectable speed, range, excellent flight characteristics, and predictable handling. The Inflatoplane's design was well suited to handle enemy gunfire due to its continuously regulated air pressure system, maintained by the engine. This meant that even when subjected to small arms fire, the plane could still remain operational and airborne. The ingenious engineering behind Goodyear's creation drew widespread fascination. Media speculated that someday, everyday individuals might be able to purchase inflatable planes. The kits were envisioned as compact and lightweight enough to be carried in family station wagons, catering to tourists, hunters, and aviation enthusiasts. However, the promising trajectory of the Inflatoplane took a tragic turn just as the excitement was growing. In 1959, 10 Inflatoplanes were provided to the Navy and Army for thorough assessment, during which significant issues swiftly emerged. A test pilot from Goodyear executed an abrupt pull-up maneuver, causing a wing to fold over and collide with the propeller. This mishap led to the immediate deflation of the aircraft, which became a tangled mass of rubber plummeting from the sky. Thankfully, the pilot managed to escape unharmed. However, a tragic incident occurred less than 2 months later when an army pilot lost his life due to a jammed control wire that forced another wing to fold. These accidents raised substantial safety concerns about inflatable aircraft. Even prior to these losses, there were valid doubts about the feasibility of the concept. The Inflatoplane required approximately 250 feet of runway for takeoff, which might not have been available to a downed pilot in a conflict-ridden area. In dense and mountainous terrains like Vietnam's forests, the Inflatoplane's usability was severely limited. Moreover, The prospect of a pilot who had been shot down from a fast, high-flying jet flying back across hostile territory in a slow, low-flying inflatable plane seemed unlikely and impractical. The question of the aircraft's utility arose. What purpose did it serve if it could be taken down with a mere pistol shot? This sentiment, though not entirely accurate, highlighted pertinent concerns. By the late 1950s, advancements in rescue operations, including the deployment of rescue helicopters with extended reach, diminished the necessity for the inflatoplane. The likelihood of the military adopting the inflatoplane into their arsenal became exceedingly slim. Consequently, Goodyear gradually phased out the project, discontinuing the production of inflatable planes after 1962. Although testing continued, the program was formally terminated in 1973. In retrospect, the practicality and potential of inflatable aircraft may have been considerably limited from the outset. Today, the inflatoplane is a fascinating footnote in aviation history, a reminder of a time when anything seemed possible and innovation was king. Though it may never have lived up to its full potential, the inflatoplane remains a symbol of the human drive to push boundaries and explore new frontiers.